Hello and welcome everyone to Cybercast episode 112, the Transformer Video Podcast Show. My name is Josh, also known as G1 Hextron. I'm joined with my co-host, James, also known as Primal Sabbath. Or, I'm sorry, Primal 77. Dude. And Dakota, also known as Primal Sabbath. And we're James, also joined by our guest, Pete Sinclair of BotCon and Transformers Collectors Club. We just had you on like a couple of weeks ago, man. So.
I think it was like 3 days ago. I don't know.
Yeah.
And then there was a show in between there.
Well, I'm glad we got to get you, you know, prior to the show, just prior and afterwards, so we can kind of get the recap and kind of get your thoughts behind the show and everything. And we've got several questions for you and some fans. They sent in some questions, and I'm sure they'll have some of the comments that we'll read off as well. But before we get into that, I know James has kind of our little plugs and our little news and stuff like that, so I'll let him get into that.
Yeah, I am James Victory Saber 77. Find me on Twitter and YouTube, and I do have Instagram, which is Victory Saber 7, because someone took Victory Saber 77, unfortunately. We do have the Aftercast, which is on my channel at 10:30 p.m. Central Standard Time. There will be no Aftercast next week because it is 4th of July, and so, sorry. Collection Spotlight, we have that back. So if you guys want your collection spotlighted on the Cybercast, just send your pictures to g1hextron@gmail.com. No collection's too small, too big. Keep your pictures, though, between, you know, 10 to 20. Unless it's a really large collection, then kind of do maybe 21. But our collection spotlight this week is Mark Manet. I'm sorry if I'm butchering your last name, but we will be taking a look at your collection after our interview. And some movie news, Star Trek Beyond is coming out, scheduled date, July 8th, 2016. There is a plan for a fourth one, Chris Pine and Zachary Quinto, I think that's his name, forgot, Spock, is signed on for that fourth installment. Also, we have Jessica Lucas is coming on to Gotham Season 2 as Tigress, and Tyrese Gibson potentially might be a new Green Lantern, which is Jon Stewart. Tom Holland has been announced as the new Spider-Man, which will be directed by John Watts. And then we have Dwayne The Rock Johnson in a video game adaptation of Rampage, or a movie adaptation of the video game Rampage, which is going to be interesting. We have trailers on Josh's G1X on Facebook page. There are Heroes Reborn, Attack on Titan. And really quick note, for legal reasons, there will not be a Marvel solo Hulk movie because they don't own the rights. And it's Universal, so probably not going to see that. And when we get into the screen sharing, guys, if you would just keep it kind of clean. We just don't want any, you know, try not to swear. Daltinius TF is our moderator, so he'll be kind of keeping an eye on that. But, you know, just kind of keep it clean. And also, if you have a question, just put question in the beginning so we can find it a lot easier since we usually have like 600, you know, replies and comments that we have to go through. So, all right, back to you, Josh.
All right, so first off, I want to thank Pete for coming on again and taking the time out of his day. Want to start off with some BotCon stuff, and then we'll kind of get into the subscription service, which I think we're all pretty excited about. But first one is, overall, how well did this year's set do compared to some of the previous years?
As far as, are you just talking about the box set or the overall or both?
Let's go with the overall, because it's kind of like a total package. I think most people, they end up, you know, kind of getting a little bit of everything there, so.
I think this year was, it's a little trickier in recent years. I don't think people are buying the duplicates like they used to, so while the set did well for the usual crowd, we're not getting a lot of the duplicate sales, so we might have to tweak the numbers on that a little bit. But overall, with the online sales, we're doing pretty okay. You know, we could have done a little better, I think, but I don't think we're not like freaking out or anything like that. So it's kind of a, you know, like I said, we wish that some duplicates maybe would have been sold, but I think a lot of people kind of just do a little wait and see now. But from our first day of online sales, went really well, so I guess they were waiting to see, and they want to see it in person, or see, you know, what the reviews are. And right now, the reviews are great, especially on the pretender we did. So, you know, overall, I think we're happy. You can always be happier, but you know, we're happy with the show. We're happy with the product we put out. We've got a ton of compliments on the item, so that's all you really can ask for. Well, not all you can ask for, but...
Well, I guess kind of a follow-up to that. I don't know how when's the last time you looked at it, but are all those sets, like all the attendee figs and the box set, are those still available on the shop store right now?
Yeah, you can get all of the Prime and the Hound are running pretty low, because those were actually the lowest number item we produced. But you can get the Prime and Hound online, the Dyclone set, the War Rooters, and we have some box sets up there as well. So if you're interested, pop on there, grab them. It's a great set. It's a great offering. So I'm very happy with how everything turned out. I freaked out a little bit when I opened the first box and looked at a couple of them because I noticed some difference from the samples. But after I looked at them a little closer, I was fine. So I always do that.
Cool. To just go into the next question, what were the production numbers for this year's box set?
Box set ran about the same as last year, which we probably should have brought it down a little bit, just to be straight up, because we're not seeing the same with the duplicate sales. So I think we'll probably look to tweak that for next year substantially, because we want to make sure everything sells out. We don't have a lot left on the site, so we'll probably bring the box set down some. Souvenirs we'll look at again. Part of the not the problem, but I guess it's a good problem to have is we're putting out so much stuff. We feel like we're draining the swamp a little bit. So as far as what people have budgets for, so I think we're gonna look at everything to make sure that everybody's getting that we're not taking away what people expect as far as people that do like having the large number of offerings, but that we also take into consideration that there is so much out there right now. We're also, granted 5 years ago we didn't have nearly the competition within the brand as we do now. You didn't have all the collector themed items and the San Diego stuff, of course, then of its car stuff, and then of course the stuff that shall remain unmentioned. I'm saying that as a joke. I'm not being serious. People would later online, he wouldn't even say what the name of it is. So I'm not like that, But
so you can see into the future, too. Gotcha.
What is it?
I said you can see into the future, too. Gotcha. Yeah.
It's amazing. But there's just so much out there. There's so much, and so we just have to take that into consideration. We have to just, take into consideration how collecting habits are changing. There were so many new people there this year, too. Kind of need to figure out what they're doing, what they want. I have not had a chance. Well, I haven't gotten them yet. They'll send me the all the feedback forms. And I will go through them probably a little closer this year than I sometimes do, just because of what tweaks we do need to make for next year. So I think that's it on that one. All right.
Cool. So I'll go ahead and lead us into the third question. This year's set was awesome. Like I was a big fan of it, especially the box set. I think that was a real winner. The Diaclone homages were really awesome. I know like that was a kind of teeter-tottering, shattered glass homage here and there deal, but will we, how well did the Diaclone stuff do, and will we kind of continue to see some more of those homages in the future?
Well, and that's the thing. They didn't do any better than the box set or the Prime and the Hound, which if you look at the Prime and Hound were super obscure, crazy, kind of left field. So I'm going to have to kind of wait and see where they go. And, of course, Takara, I guess, has just announced some Diaclone stuff they're working on. So, I don't know. I mean, there's nothing on our agenda right now for next year. Will we come back to it? It all just depends. I'm not exactly sure. I just heard something about Diaclone and Takara with the show going on. It was just craziness. I didn't really get to pay attention to anything else that was going on. So,
right.
Right now I'm very happy we were finally able to do this set. I think I like the burnout, but the lift ticket is just phenomenal. I think he's just, the other one's the she, is great. Sorry, took me a second. I'm very happy with them. I'm glad we were able to, the file cards for them were straight up die clone, and the characterizations were die clone, so very excited about them, but I don't know if and when we'll be doing anything else. So, like I said, we'll have to wait and see.
All right, speaking of the Diaclone stuff, to get the drivers for the Diaclone set, you had to buy the General Optimus Prime and Sergeant Hound set. Is there any reason why of this, or was it just a mix-up?
Yeah, I honestly, I think the idea to make the drivers, to make the Target Masters, right, from the Hound, to make them connected to the Diaclones, I think that came after we had already put everything in stone as far as what toys were coming with what. I know that we wanted to, I don't remember exactly how the chain of events went. I just know that we wanted to do the colorizations for them to match some Diaclones, and then we made the decision that in the fiction they would actually be the Diaclone drivers for Lift Ticket and Burnout. So I do know that decision was made. I just don't remember, to be honest with you. I just know it wasn't like a mix-up. It wasn't like, oh, shoot, they were supposed to come with that. I just think it as things progressed, we thought, okay, we really need to tie these in together. But, you know.
So, because a lot of people, they're doing their speculations, as they will. So it wasn't a thing to where it's like, oh, you want those? Well, you got to buy this set, too.
No.
So, okay.
No, I mean, it works out that, and, you know, you never don't want people to buy those sets.
Right.
But no, that was more of a fiction thing. I mean, it was, you know, I don't even know if we mentioned them on the, I'd have to go back and look at the file cards. But see, that the file cards and that stuff is done so much later in the process. You know, I don't know if we went back kind of retroactively, said, okay, we got
these. They are mentioned, by the way.
They are mentioned on the file cards?
At least on Burnout for Daya. And I like the names Daya and Klein. I thought that was real nifty.
Well, then, I guess you need to buy both sets. But, so, yeah, so there you go. But, yeah, no, it wasn't any, you know, slick marketing move or anything like that. But
moving in the shadows, as you always do.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, you know us. So.
Let's see. The next question we kind of already answered, so I'm going to just skip to six. Having Frank Welker at this year's BotCon was great. Can we expect to see him more? And is there any chance Peter Cullen would be a guest in the near future?
Yeah, I mean, it just depends. I mean, the Frank Welker thing went off without a hitch. I mean, it really did. It was great because I, you know, they used the term handler, so that was my role for him. But it wasn't, you know, didn't feel like that, I guess, because he was just so laid back, so easy to talk to. Agent was great. Kevin Motley, he was great to deal with. So we talked about it, you know, what we could do for the future. But, you know, the one thing Frank did say, we were talking, I asked him, we were driving back, because he was at a different hotel, and it was about a 20-minute commute between hotels, and I made that trip like 10 times, which was fine. It was no big deal. I mean, you know, I'm driving with Frank Welker for 20 minutes. And that's in addition to all the time I spent with him just at the show during the breaks and you know, did lunch twice and stuff like that. So, I mean, it was a great personal experience for me. But I did ask him on Saturday after the panel. I asked him as we were driving back. I asked him, what was your overall feel of the show? Now that we've done two autograph sessions, you did two pictures, and you did your panel. You know, how do you feel about things? And he told me, he said, I don't feel like anybody didn't get their experience, meaning that, or that anybody was disappointed in their experience. He said everybody that came in to see me had a smile on their face. They were happy. They didn't seem like they got shortchanged on spending some time with me, you know, and having a conversation back and forth, and that it was definitely a mutual. You know, they seemed happy. I was happy. He was very complimentary of us. I will toot our own horn in that regard. He said, you know, everything ran like it was on military time. Everything was completely on schedule for that. I know sometimes we get zinged on the panels and running a little late on those because it just seems like there's always making those transitions. There's always some hiccup, it seems like. But everything went extremely smoothly on that. And there was a third thing he told me, and now it's driving me nuts that I can't remember, and I'll remember it later. But, shoot, I can't remember. But I'll remember it later. But yeah, but he just was very impressed with everything. Was impressed with the fans. Had a great time. I know he'd be open to doing it again. It's awesome that we were the first show that he's done. I'm sure he'll do other shows. We know he's doing other shows, but I'm sure there'll be more, maybe on a semi-regular basis for him now. But yeah, it was it went well. I mean, I cannot complain. It was just perfect. And I think the one comment his agent made was when we were talking about when people asked about the steak dinner, and he didn't have any comments on it because he couldn't remember it. And his agent was like, well, that's why we got to have Peter here. You got to have Peter here because then Peter could jump right in and say what the steak dinner story was about. So Peter's been to 8 BotCons. So, you know, having them both at a show, we've already toyed around with the idea. I don't think we'd do that next year. Next year's not a movie year. But I think something for a movie year, that would be pretty huge. So it's something to think about.
Cool.
So we probably would But
I was going to say, I'd like to piggyback off of that. I noticed in the club store you had the kind of non-attending Frank Welker experience thing. You get the awesome lithograph, which is a great, great piece of art, and it's signed in the pen. I thought that was really neat for you guys to throw up in the store. And the autograph cards with his signature and Susan and John's as well.
Yeah, that was, we didn't sell the full maximum, and we had a maximum number we could sell. We didn't meet that number. And I don't think it was a lack of interest. I think it was more how we kind of made the pricing structure. I know it was a little pricey if you wanted to do everything, and I think that's something we'll look at for the future to make sure everybody can get that package. This was our first time out doing something like this. So we wanted to make sure Primus package holders had the first dibs on everything. We didn't really get it out there that there were other ways towards the end because we needed to meet that number. But, you know, since we had some extra tickets. We had them, sign the extra prints, and the total number is still the same. So we've got those non-attending ones, and those are selling in the store right now pretty well. So hopefully sell all those out, and everybody gets their little piece of the VIP pass. So, but yeah, the print was awesome. That was Casey. I worked with him on that, and he's incredible.
Dakota, you got 7. Is Dakota froze?
He's just listening so intently right now.
I think he's froze. So
keep talking. What? What's that? He's like waiting.
Tell me more.
So Frank was great, Dakota. I know he enjoyed meeting you. What?
All right, so I'll jump to number 7.
I just want him to be up for the rest of the thing. Awesome.
Let's see if I can even. No, I won't even focus on him, so we can only see him in the smaller thing. But I'll jump to number 7.
Yeah, now it's turned angry. Now he's just mad at me.
It seems general admission was a little bit lower than previous years. Do you think this was because of location or? Where did it go? Do you think this is because of location or some other reason?
I can't comment on that because I have not gotten the... that's the one thing we haven't talked about. The office was closed on Tuesday and Wednesday, and then Brian and I talked for a while on Friday about 2016 and lessons we can take from this one. I have still not... And usually I get the general admission numbers on Sunday, but I have been so... I was so... It was just crazy nonstop. I didn't actually get a. I haven't even asked. The only thing I was told, I was talking to Carl, and I'm not sure. I don't know if it was the size of the room, or the activities, or the panel room pulling so many people out, or other events that were going on. But I'm not hearing that general admission was off by as much as some people were kind of speculating. I heard that we already had by that afternoon 1,000 people through the door, just general admission, and that's. Kind of by Saturday, by the afternoon, that's kind of on par with a non-movie year. So I'd have to kind of, find out, but from what I'm hearing, it wasn't, I think it was the size of the room, the amount of activities that kind of, spread it out a little bit more. Sometimes people take a larger dealer room, they don't take into account the fact that the amount of space we have between the booths. We do that intentionally so it's not crazy. You know, we get amount of space. I mean, we actually filled up. That's actually the way we had the dealer room set up was that was the maximum number of viewers we could put in there too, because we want that extra space. I know some shows want you crammed in there to give it a feel of completely packed. But we don't really feel like we need to put out that image just to make people uncomfortable so you can't move between aisles. I've been to shows like that. You know how miserable that is, where you are literally bumping into people trying to walk in between exhibitor booths. So, like I said, once I have the final numbers, I'll be happy to talk more to that, but I just can't right now because I haven't really gotten that yet. So,
okay,
that's fine. 2016 stuff.
Okay. Next question. Can you give us any hints on where BotCon might be next year and or when will it be officially announced?
I know Brian loves to use his Alaska joke. I don't know why he doesn't start using a Hawaii joke. I mean, because who's going to argue about Hawaii? We know about where we're going. We just have to, until we get things signed on the dotted line, we can't really comment. But we are going to be out sooner this year, out more ahead of time. I think that's the one thing, you know, we definitely want to make sure, despite all the ridiculous registration issues that we ran into, whether it was our fault or the fault of the company or the fault of us for sticking with a company like that, however you want to slice it, the point is we are taking every step we can to make sure that is avoided for next year and to make sure things are out ahead of time and that and there's plenty of time to plan and build up and get ready for 2016. So,
if I could make a couple of suggestions, Dallas, you know, it's not too far from DFW, or even Love Field from there, or Austin, man, that would be a great location, plus it being during the summer. All the University of Texas people, all those kids are gone, so you still get, you know, the fantastic city with all the music, all the food, everything there, but you also, it's not going to be as crowded as it would be during the school year, so...
Yeah, we won't be St. Charles-esque next year. I mean, I know that presented all kinds of challenges for some people. I don't think it was nearly as bad as people wanted to think it was. I mean, that resort does all kinds of conferences. That's just kind of the way it is as far as the, you know, how you commute back and forth to the airport. I don't think people would have wanted to be any closer to Chicago because that city is just, the traffic is crazy. I can't even imagine. We had to cancel our tour on Thursday because they canceled the hop. You couldn't do the hop on, hop off anywhere. That was what the tour was supposed to be. And then they had we're expecting 3.2 million people down there for the parade.
Oh, wow.
Just, first of all, it's hockey. Second of all, hey, there he is.
Oh, it's back.
I missed.
Sorry, the little hamster that's running on the wheel that runs my computer just,
But
internet.
But yeah, we had to do away with that tour. Restructured it very quickly. Wednesday night, came up with a new tour, and it worked out. They were actually really excited. They ended up going to some Galloping Ghost arcade, and I guess they were thrilled with that because it was just some, the penny arcade type thing where it was just. Or not penny, whatever, quarter arcade, whatever they call them now. But yeah, it was just, I guess they wanted to stay longer. So.
All right, let me put this in here for Dakota. Dakota, you're on 9. Go.
I got to scroll up. Okay, for Bigger Subscription Service 4.0, why did you decide to go with the Mayhem Attack Squad?
Just pandering, you know. Yeah. Just playing off everybody's 80s nostalgia. No, I mean, it's perfect. I mean, it just. I don't know, because it looks like it's going to sell well. I mean, I don't know. I mean, why did we decide? All right, I'm not mocking. I'm just saying it really boils down to that. I mean, I think, you know, we know what Hasbro's doing. You know, we knew we wanted to do something Combiner Wars and do more of a tighter theme for the subscription for 4.0. And I think Jesse suggested it. I don't remember the suggestion process. I know I didn't suggest it. But I think Jesse just suggested, not Jesse Wittenrich, who I work with on a lot of stuff. I think he threw out, you know,
once he saw those, threw out these guys. I said those look awesome. And I think I said I told him I wanted Bludgeon. And I wanted to have the inner robot head, because we've seen the skull head enough times. And of course the combined head will be kind of we'll do something cool with that, I'm sure. But yeah, just because they're gonna look pretty awesome.
Cool. So I guess
six figure too, which I'm not gonna announce on your show, but we did we did decide on the six figure, and I think people are gonna be thrilled with it. So we worked on that this past week. That one kind of fell off the
flywheels.
Calling it right now. It's gonna be the Radio Shack Shockwave.
Look.
Radio Shack.
You're talking about Galactic Man or Astro Man? Yeah, I wanted
It was supposed to be Blackjack, and we were gonna do him as Axer, and he was gonna, because we were gonna use a different mold for Bludgeon, but that one we're not using. Just for whatever reason they don't want us using that one. So we are gonna use the Onslaught mold, which is gonna be awesome. But you don't need the Legends guy. So we've got a six guy, and he actually is gonna be a deluxe, not a Legends.
That's
even better. So you're not getting enough. You'll get five deluxes and a Voyager.
That's the total. Now, okay, I want to make sure that I click on you so that we're looking at you. You don't have to say anything. I wrote this down. I just want to say flywheels and see what your reaction is. Do I get a smirk? Anything?
I don't know.
All right.
There's no plans for him right now. People are like, I don't get it. Well, they're not doing flywheels. I don't want battle trap. I'm like, really? I mean, was that important to have? Like, I don't get it. I'm happy with having flywheels. I mean, flywheels. Battle trap. I mean, I don't need. I don't know. Maybe. I've got to read through the feedback forums. If I read on there and, 80% of the people or 40% of people are like, oh my gosh, I need flywheels, then we'll figure it out. You know, I said before, and then we end up doing it. So, whatever.
All right. Well, Jim, you want to go with 10, and then we'll just reverse it. Yeah.
Okay. So going off of that. Same question. Was this the collaboration that you kind of talked to us about before with Hasbro? If so, will the subscription service now be more closely related to Hasbro toy themes of the future?
So we went into the meetings in January when we were up there in Rhode Island. We take them a proposal, and we had, what did we have? We had BotCon. We had BotCon 2016. We had 4.0 and 5.0. I remember showing it to them. And they looked through the BotCon. They're like, okay, that's cool. That's cool. They got to 4.0. They're like, oh, that's awesome. Oh, look. Oh, you got him. He's like, there's Bludgeon and Windsweeper. All they combine. It's Combiner Wars. It's great. And then we get 5.0. And they're like, oh, okay, that's cool. That's cool. So quickly we discovered they want us to tie in more with what's going on with the brand. So we restructured 5.0. Actually, I didn't mean to say 5.0. We restructured 4.0, now let me try this again. We restructured the BotCon 2016 offerings to align a little bit more with what they're going to have going on in 2016. So it doesn't really necessarily tell you what we're doing. I'm just saying it just aligns a little more. And then 5.0 is actually kind of semi-aligned, but we're also kind of doing our own thing. Kind of a mix of the two, but they all work together. And I think people are going to be thrilled. I always say that. So, but I think they will, because I'm very excited about. I like 4.0, but 5.0, I'm really anxious to get going on. So, there'll be some cool stuff there.
All right, I think 11 kind of went in with that. Next question is update Nexus Prime. Yes, no, or maybe. I guess you can kind of assume who that question came from.
No, it's so funny because people were like, it's hilarious because they were, when they first came out back in 05, 06, they're like, oh, they're just little, whatever they were called back then, the basics or whatever the name was for them during Energon. And, oh, they're translucent red and blue and blah, 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 blah. They didn't seem really that hot on them. And now everyone's like, oh, you got to do Nexus Prime. You got to do Nexus Prime. So, I mean, that's awesome because it's a great character, but, it sucks because it's so hilarious that we get to do 25 to 30 toys a year, and that's like a huge number of toys that we get to do. But then like there's, you know, but then there's always like, you know, well, if we could do 60, well, yeah, we do Nexus Prime, and we do Flywheels, and we do this, and we do that. So, yeah, it'd be great to do a new version of Nexus Prime. I just don't know if we'll be able to or when. Because by the time we get through doing everything we want to do, Hasbro will be on to their next theme. And I'm not sure if their next theme has been officially announced or how all that's worked, so I'm not going to say it. But you know, we're already kind of planning on tying in with what their next theme will be. And by, you know, by the time we get to the next stuff, well, they're already on to that. So like, well, do we have time? Do we then to go back and do it? Or is there going to be so much cool stuff with this new thing? And I saw an overview of it and saw some specific characters and I'm like, yeah, but there's going to be so many opportunities there. So it's like, what do you, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I would worry about the idea of doing another 5-year combiner.
Oh God, please don't. Like, just give it all at once.
That's a long time. And we're excited, and you know, so, you know, we're doing the Ramjet and the Skywarp, so I hope people dig that. People are like, how are you going to do the thing on his head? Well, we got to figure that out still. We will. Might just sculpt it as a new weapon or something like that that comes off the head, but, you know, we've always, with the sculptors we use, they obviously, if they can do like Oil Master, they can figure out how to do a thing on his head, so I'm not worried about that.
I guess that would lead me into 13. Are we doing that now? That rotation?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Would it be safe to assume we can look forward to the only human versions of Springer and Ultra Magnus, assuming all of these human characters we're getting do well?
If they, you know, that's all. I mean, right now, the we definitely, obviously, are doing Marissa and Old Snake. We'll be starting Rodimus and RC here soon. We've got another set planned for next year, which we haven't announced yet. But so we've got something even bigger and cooler. But as far as whether or not we do a carded Magnus and Springer, that will all depend on how RC and Rodimus sell.
So RC and Rodimus are this year and not next year? I thought they were next year.
When I say this year, you have to understand. When I say this year, that means what my current... it's next year, but when I say this year, I'm sorry. Sometimes I do that. That's what I'm working on right now. Like my 12-month cycle that starts, you know. Yeah, you're like, dang on it. But,
So
but yeah, they do great. If they, you know, we have to expect both the Transformers and the Joe Club to kind of, you know, support them. If they support them, we'll do more. I think Joe people will buy them too because they are Joe tooling. But
yeah,
we'll find out.
Now, with that being said, guys, the money that you might have spent on Masterpiece Optimus Primal, use that to buy multiple sets of the Only Human Hot Rod and RC. Am I right, Pete?
Well, I don't want to say don't spend money with you don't spend money on Takara. They don't deserve your money.
I just don't want any Beast Wars stuff. I want the sales to be really bad so that, you know, they're like, oh, we're not going down that road again.
But we need our Masterpiece Only Human figures. We need 12-inch versions of Rodimus and RC.
Oh God, that would make Savage like extremely happy.
Oh, it would be. Hey, hold on, just a quick second. I promise.
All right, start looking, guys.
All right, here I'll click on his screen, guys. Start looking for the new stuff. Where's it at? Where's he got?
You know what's funny is where's it?
Something on glass. Is that a new cinema?
It's kind of sad now because my desk is all clear now. Nothing. This is where I keep all the samples and stuff that come in. I put them all here. So there's nothing. I got like a production Hound and an Optimus here, but I've moved everything. I always do this right after the show. I move everything over to the... Can you see that okay?
Yeah.
That looks nice.
I move everything over to the... So I've got all the current Bakon this year's toys. I theme mine, too. I keep it like a... Like, those are the pirates. That's all the pirates. That's all the Wings of Honor. That's all G2 and... what was that called? The Machine Wars stuff. And then this shelf is... Axiom Nexus or no, I guess it's pretty much all Axie. Well, it's like you got like the Beast Wars Uprising right here, the three dudes, Chrome Dome, Rewind, and Dreadshot that were in that little offshoot continuity, and then like the what was those two guys' names? Bizatron and Barricade from that little offshoot continuity, and then this is all like my right here. This is all the Axiom Nexus guys. You've got the dudes around the poker table, Jackpot and Circuit, and them, and you got Thrustinator.
I was the only one.
Huh?
Nothing. Nothing. Just admiring it. That's probably my favorite wall in your room.
Yeah. Well, I've got all. If you look up, I've got the. So up here, you've got.
Nice.
All the pre-Beast War stuff, the Dawn's of Futures Past stuff, all the animated stuff, and then this is the Classics shelf, and then here's the Shattered Glass shelf right here, but then right here is the Axiom Nexus. So that's how I keep everything kind of themed. A few pieces are in the... It's funny, I've got a few things over at the I guess more than a few, not to sound pretentious, but I've got a bunch of stuff over at the Indianapolis Children's Museum. And I redid the, I had to pull everything off that to redo that shelf, and I redid that shelf, and I want to redo the, get the dust in and clean up that shelf right there, but they've got my, the Shattered Glass, they've got my Prime and the Soundwave, and then that shelf they've got the Kickoff and a couple of other ones. I don't really want to mess with them until I get them back. I guess I get them back next month. That's why my shelves are so jacked up behind me, because they're all, a bunch of stuff still there. So I'm looking forward to getting all that stuff back and putting my office back together, I guess. But yeah, so anyways, when I, right after the show, as I'm putting all my stuff away, I get the shelf set up, and I put all the current toys over there so I can start making room for whatever we're working on next. So we'll get the, we'll start, I guess the 4.0 will be next. So we'll start getting that over to them, and then I'll start getting samples of those, and I just sent Lanny the, I pulled the, yeah, I got my hole right there. Right there. There was my, Needle Nose and, Spinister and Windsweeper and guys. So they're at him, so he'll batch. I think we're going to go very toy with the decos, go based on the toy colors, because, I mean, they weren't in the animation. And the comic books all over the place. I think we're just going to go straight up toy colors with them. So he needs those toys. Because if we go up the animation, I don't send him the toy, right? Because there's no point. But with the Mayhem guys, yeah, they'll all pretty much be toy-based when it comes to the coloring. So I sent him the five of them. So.
All right, Jim, I think you got the last question from us, and then we'll get into... I've plugged in like a lot of the fan questions here.
Okay, would it be safe to assume that the 5.0 will use the Combiner Wars Brawl as Quake, since the mold will be available then? You can just smile for a yes, or we've thought about it.
It's funny you mention that. I did get, when we were looking for a sixth guy for the 4.0, I think Jesse sent me Quake and... Quake and somebody else. But they both ended up in my trash. So, I know that's going to break your heart. But no, we decided we wanted an Autobot. So I guess I will go ahead and give away that the sixth guy is an Autobot. Mm. But no, no plans for Quake right now. I'm sorry.
Michael. All right, we'll go ahead and get it. What's up, man? He's like, I think I remember these guys. Yeah. We'll go ahead and get into the first question. This is from Facebook. This is Russell Paul DeBose, I believe is how you say it. He said,
Dubois.
It's, okay. Ask him if maybe now they can use the Masterpiece Bumblebee mold and give us some exclusives, because now we know that Hasbro, like, they're going to be coming out with a G2 Bumblebee, or at least in Australia, which means that Hasbro is going to have the right to the molds, and then you're going to get the Shrieks and stuff. Since Bumblebee's one of those cheaper ones, do you think that that's something that you guys might target as far as a glyph or something else like that that we know we probably wouldn't get as far as, you know, Takara releasing Masterpiece?
I've got to check into that and see how that all works. I need to check with the team and see how licensing works with the Masterpiece. I'm just not sure right now. What? I'm just not sure how the licensing works on those. I think we'd like to. And we really should look into that. I just am wary of what we would have to charge for a Masterpiece toy. Because you already know what they cost at retail, so it's like, you know, what do we have to charge? We have to charge, you know, $110 each just for the base toy or what? So, hey, can I do the end of this real quick? We can watch Titans. Can we watch Titans for a minute?
I think we've got about 5 or 6 questions left here. You got another one by Russell. If you want to get that, Dakota.
He wants to know if it's possible for you to do a BotCon combiner. Then he follows it up with that would be awesome.
If we can do a BotCon combiner, like for like doing
like the box set. I would assume like in the box set, like the box set is just a combiner.
Well, baby, I'd suck at poker.
Nexus Prime 2016. I don't know.
I know, that's why we just like we're just gonna mention something and we'll just watch your face.
It's so funny because Brett's the same way. I was kind of hounding him Tuesday night about the custom class, and you know, a couple of folks were like, "Oh, it's gonna be the Scoop Mold," and I looked him dead in the eye and I went, "It's gonna be Galvalio Convoy, isn't it?" He just I don't know. I was like, come on, dude.
No, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's, I don't know. It's, I don't know. Stay tuned.
We'll just leave it at it sure would be cool.
Stay tuned. Well,
All right, awesome.
It's the Galvalio Convoy we completely gave away on the box for no problem, too.
Very true.
You saw that, right?
Yeah.
People were pointing it out after the fact. They were like, and there he was the whole time.
Is there a third space for it? Yeah, I remember that.
I drop little hints every once in a while, too. Like, in the one surprise egg video, it might have been the last one where I was getting kind of goofy. And I quoted the Batman, the Joker from Batman. I said a little song, a little dance. I said the General's head on a lance. So that was my way of just saying we were doing General Optimus Prime. So I don't know. No one's going to pick it up, but it amused me, so that's all really matters.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're like listening intently to every word. He said...
Well, one of the funnest things about having you on the show or whenever you go on to any show is to watch the forums afterwards. You know, they post it, they're like, Pete was on, and like they like do the breakdowns and like hang on to every little, oh, he smiled here, you know, and so this, and then the speculation just goes, and it's usually pretty fun to watch those things. So
well, I'm glad I just don't have any toys out this time. Fortunately, I was debating on putting. I knew what I was gonna do. Is he right behind me? Yeah, he is. So Jesse did this up, and I'll show it to you. And I'm weary of showing this. I'm afraid people are gonna ask for it. And I don't think. Well, why not? We'll put it out there and see. And this was sitting in the room, and a couple people saw it and were flipping out. The people, because I had some people over to the room and. For the after party, and
that entire floor was nothing but like us BotCon people.
Yeah, fourth floor was where it was at. So, yeah, but it was.
Ooh,
yeah.
You can see who that is, right?
Oh yeah,
yeah.
That's really cool.
I don't know. I mean, the head actually works too, because you can you bend the head down and I mean, how does it work? Where does the head go? Something. I don't know.
The chest covers it up, I think.
How did that work? I was doing it earlier. And it... Well, anyways, the point is it worked when you... I think it works when you transform it. So I don't know. It'd be kind of cool looking, but I just don't know if it... I mean, obviously we would do a whole new face, and we would probably try to make sure that we didn't run into the same face issues as... we'd have to look in and having a different factory do it because there was that issues with the factory that did the Metal Hawk. Yeah, he's kind of... That'd be kind of cool, I guess. I don't know.
So as of right now, that's just a custom, but it's something that you wouldn't mind playing around with the idea of.
No. I mean, we'll see. I mean, like I said, you throw something like this out there, and maybe people go crazy, or maybe it's an afterthought. But I don't know. Yeah, there was another. I can't remember where what other custom there was, but yeah, Jesse will sometimes do these and just kind of go like, oh, and it'll sometimes spark an idea, or it just ends up being. I mean, I had that same Waspinator, and I had that Waspinator from the Machine Wars Sky War, but nothing's ever going to happen with that. But that's different because we've already done. You know, Waspinator's been done a billion times. Pretender Starscream. I don't know. Maybe.
All right. Who's got the tool unlock question?
I do. Do you think you'll ever do more unreleased stuff like Oil Master? And if so, any ideas or hints that you could give us?
Yeah, it kind of stinks. We actually had for 5.0, I guess they weren't unreleased. We were going to use two really old molds from Europe exclusive ones, and new decos, but the molds, I guess, are gone. That made me sad. Unreleased stuff, though. People keep asking about that spider. That spider is just a big glob of goo with arms. I don't understand what we could even do with that. We'd have to redesign that so much for it to even look appealing. I understand it's, you know, sometimes something looks good. Oh, my gosh, you got to do the spider now. But if we were to do something else unreleased, it probably would be not him. And then if we did do him, it'd be so redesigned that it wouldn't even really look like him. It would be inspired by. But as far as other unreleased stuff, we've looked at a bunch of stuff, actually. And it's tricky. We've looked at the Buffalo dump truck. We looked at... who was it? I can't think what the guy's name is. We used him in one of the Wings stories. But it's another Japanese concept. It just, you know, unless you're creating an... The Pretender was easy because it wasn't a ton of new tools. There's no screws. There's no, you know, you don't have to create, you know, all these different parts. It was easy. So outside of Pretenders, it gets tricky. I'm still all for Action Masters. Didn't I talk about that last time?
Yeah, like doing a box set Action Masters.
Yeah. I want to do, because you could actually use the same back of the, you know, chest or whatever, or the legs. There's all kinds of things you could do. I'd love to do those, but I just don't think they'd sell. Not in the quantities we'd need. I mean, Hasbro already tried it once. It didn't work in 1990. I don't know. I don't know if it works 25 years later. I think the nostalgia only gives it more sometimes.
Let's see. The next question, I think Dakota already answered that in the chat for them. The next one is Tony Hectic. Says, in years past, the Transformer Collectors Club figures were old molds. This year we have current molds and new molds. Is this something that will continue in the future?
Yeah, I think I think that goes to the whole us being a little bit more hand in hand with what Hasbro's doing at retail. That's why we're using, you know, that's why we announced a mold that hasn't even been released yet with Onslaught, and that was at their suggestion. I think you'll see us being pretty much in line with what they're doing at retail, and you may have a toy that comes out from us that might have just hit the shelves a few months prior. So the short answer is yes.
Okay. And who's got the last one there? And then I had one thing that I wanted to ask as well.
Go ahead.
You got it?
Or it doesn't matter. I'm here.
Transformers Guy 223, what is the hardest project you've had to work on?
Probably that Scorponok. That was a pain in the butt. The Pretender was easy, comparatively speaking, but the Scorponok was pain because we had to figure out for the chest thing, because, you know, doing a retool like that, you know, doing a new arm or doing a new head, I'm not saying any of it's easy, but trying to figure out the chest thing, and then there was the rod that went through his chest, and then we wanted the head to rotate initially, but that couldn't work, and then we needed to raise the head up because you couldn't actually, because when you created, that's what the rod was about, when you created a new piece, there was the rod there, so the head couldn't go into there, so it hit the rod. So you had to create the neck piece, and I was freaking out that it was going to look goofy having that neck on there. Originally it was like just a circle thing that would swivel, and that looked ridiculous. So then we said, look, you just need to do a square. So we did square, and then what type of deco do you put on there? And then the thing comes back, and I've got the sample downstairs, and then the pinchers wouldn't close because they didn't skim enough off the top, so the pinchers aren't closing. Everything's the wrong color. I'm flipping out. So we sent them a giant list of stuff that needs to be corrected, and then we never saw another sample. So at that point, you can only hope it shows up right. So I was actually very, what's the word I'm looking for? Not sound, whatever. Because it's not an easy job, but is fun, I guess, as people could say the job is. That you, oh my gosh, you have to work with the toys and stuff like that. It can actually be very nerve-wracking, too. So when you have something like that, where you're actually kind of going out on a limb and you want to do something new and you want to do something different, and then you get that first sample back and it's all kinds of wrong, it freaks you out a little bit because you're like, if this doesn't work out, you're going to look stupid. You're going to have egg on your face. And it's not like we never have enough other issues sometimes. It feels like, the one thing we kind of sometimes can feel like we're doing right is the toys and stuff like that, even though there's a misstep here or there. Counterpunch. You're hoping that, this is a great idea. Please let the execution be there. And it was very nerve-wracking. Oil Master, not as much. But it was stressful. So that would be the hardest and most stressful thing I've dealt with as far as the toys. And then the most disappointing was the Counterpunch. I remember seeing that and just being just devastated because I was like, we thought so much about that and worked so hard on that, and we thought we had it designed right. And this was before the digital sculpting, so maybe that kind of had something to do with it. Maybe the initial design wasn't the original turnaround there were some issues with. I think it was a multitude of issues, and we didn't even see a sample until it was already produced, and I still have yet to open it. I still have never taken that toy. That is literally the only toy I have never taken out of a package and transformed. I have every single other toy. He's on my shelf. He's in a box. I have every other toy transformed, and every other toy I've transformed at some point, that's still the only toy of the 150 or so we produced that I've never actually taken out and transformed. I just don't even want to.
It's not as bad as the internet makes
it. It was supposed to be so awesome.
It's a little bad, but it's not like that bad.
Yeah, it was enough to break my heart.
Pete, you can do no wrong when it comes to Dakota.
Worships
the ground you guys walk on. So, this is something that
I know, it was ridiculous. Like at the show, he kept like I couldn't. He was like literally like kneeling every time I got on the elevator. I'm like, what are you doing?
Oh, okay. Now we're gonna go that route. All right.
This is getting embarrassing.
I was like, hey Pete, you want some White Castle?
I know. Did you be there for the White Castles?
Dude, me and Alex and Jason, we were the ones that built that monstrous, awesome castle on the bar.
Did you? Yeah. That was good stuff. The only mistake I made there was not getting enough cheese, and Alex tried to tell me. He's like, you need more cheese. I'm like, no, you only need 30 cheese. You need 100 regular.
Dude, they were all, like, obliterated within minutes.
Yeah, that was good times.
Yeah.
I had 6 or 7.
Hey, Pete, I had one last thing. This is something that you kind of brought up before, with all the other conventions going around. And last year, it being the 30th anniversary of Transformers, 20th anniversary of BotCon, we got a few reveals, but they were, for the most part, it was kind of like silhouettes, like the silhouette of Superion. And then we saw, like, Minasaur and Superion at San Diego Comic-Con. This year, it seemed like you guys got the big reveals. Now, we don't know what we're going to see at San Diego, but it seems like there was a lot more being revealed at this year's BotCon versus, last year's or even the.
Are you staying with Hasbro or with us or both?
With Hasbro, like they came out with the Skylinks, that was awesome. Bruticus. These are things that like last year those were announced, at San Diego or shown off. Well, they were actually shown off at your convention this year.
Yeah, did that? I mean, unfortunately, I didn't get to see. I mean, I had seen them. I had seen the toys, but I didn't know what were what was actually being announced and what wasn't being announced at their panel. I just knew that Bruticus was because we had to make sure. Honey, hop down for a second. Hop down. I knew Bruticus was because we had to make sure before. I emailed them like the week before. I'm like, oh, by the way, are you showing Bruticus? Because we've got Onslaught in our presentation, and they were, so we were good to show that. But yeah, I think Hasbro, I think, totally recognizes how important that they have a very dedicated fan base at BotCon, and they have a, you know, they have a very word I'm looking for. They have the attention of everybody, you know, as opposed to being in San Diego. Not that San Diego is not important, but being in San Diego, you've got a million and one things going on.
Right.
BotCon for that week, all eyes are on Hasbro, on Transformers. I'm sure it was no accident that Takara was talking about stuff because everybody's paying attention to Transformers right then, and that's important. So I think they realize that. We realize that. You know, we all kind of put out the amount of the appropriate amount of info and reveals to make sure you keep people engaged, but then also make sure you've got stuff to keep them engaged year round. So, you know, so yeah, I think it was a, I think it was a great thing. People were very excited. I guess the Skylink's got all kinds of, people were really excited about that and didn't have any clue that was coming. Was there any even hints? Did people even know that that was coming at all?
We called it like 2 years ago because whenever they came out with that Hasbro book, they had like 30 different characters in there, and every single one of those characters, except for Skylink's, it was like Defensor and Skylink's were the last ones that they have done some type of, like, come out with in some type of form or reissued, like they did with Six Shot was in there. They did a reissue with him. So the last one was Skylink's.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, people were kind of giving poor John a little bit of a hard time with that one video, I guess. They did, like, those Combiner War videos, and I guess they were giving him a little bit of a hard time, but they don't, really don't get it. He's awesome. John is so on the ball. I mean, he came from G.I. Joe and did some amazing work on Joe, and the stuff that he's doing on Transformers and the stuff they've got planned for down the road is just incredible. And I mean, people, I guess, are just in love with that Devastator. And I think people, I mean, I think I've said this before on your show, or I said it on other shows, there's just so much awesome stuff that's on its way. And this is just I would say it's the tip of the iceberg, but it's like you know, because we've already seen the tip, but, you know, there's still a lot of iceberg to come. Sorry, it's like a George Bush.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great time to be a Transformer fan. There's a lot of stuff going on, so.
Yeah, so, but yeah, to answer your question, or I guess I already didn't answer, is I think there was, they realized the importance of that. There was a ton of great reveals. We wanted to make sure that we were able to, you know, be a part of that, and I think people were thrilled. So, you have anything to say, buddy? No? Well, it's because you don't talk.
Well, I want to thank you for, you know, coming on again, and hopefully they, you know, do the same thing next year as well, because I know that was something that us, you know, BotCon fans wanted to see more of those reveals there versus San Diego, because there's just so much going on at San Diego that, you know, I think they realize, you know, the potential of, you know, like, getting that news to basically its core cat or its core fans there. So hopefully it continues, man.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I think the show was, it seemed like there was something there for everyone. We were extremely happy with it. I mean, it was a great show. It was actually one of the, there's not many shows where I'm like, I have the, what are they called, the BotCon blues or the, you kind of go through that BotCon withdrawal, and I was on such a high Sunday, you know, I was like Monday night, and I was like, oh, man, for the first time in a long time, I wish I could be back there, because usually I'm so beat and ready to be home, because it's work for me. I mean, it is work, not that I don't enjoy my job, but it is work, and I was just, usually I'm just so beat, but it was just everybody was just having such a great time. People kept coming up to me, just telling me what a great time they had and how much fun they were having, and you know, it just, it's kind of sad it was over this year, so we need to get back to it quick.
All right, well, do you guys have anything for let Pete go?
No.
Just,
thanks for being on, man. That was really cool. Looking forward to next year's BotCon.
Yeah, we'll be back on again sooner than later, and hopefully we'll have some more stuff to talk about.
Awesome. Well, thank you. Both of you. Thank you.
Yes. Right.
Okay, say bye.
Bye.
Bye. All right, see you guys.
See ya.
Later, man.
See you later, man.
All right, I think there was one question in here. What was it? Donobot Maximize says, I recently got a BotCon figure, namely the BotCon 2006 Donobot. Complete, I paid $60. Did I pay too much?
So, I thought Dakota answered that.
Yeah. Dakota, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. It's a box set figure, so, I think that was a good price. I think the one that really fetches a lot out of that box set is Primal, just for the obvious reasons. It's big, he's a leader, and stuff like that. So I think $60 just for Dinobot and what's otherwise a, $700 box set-ish isn't bad at all.
Oh, yeah, it's a nice, but, if you want to complete that box set, it's going to kind of suck because you're not going to get the other guys for a cheap price.
Which in a sense, it's like, I see some loose sets going up and stuff like that, so it isn't too bad.
So if that's the only one that you want, then you're good.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Everybody can see what's on screen. I'm not going to have to do any editing, correct?
I don't see it. I'm just kidding. I do.
Okay. Don't mess with me, Jim. All right, so this is the collection spotlight we didn't do it last week, just too many tabs, but we do every week. You guys send in your collection, just like James said at the beginning of the show, that just email your collection, about 20 pictures, depending on the size of it, to g1hextron@gmail.com. Please don't send it some other way. I'll try to keep it all organized, so just try to send it just this one way here. But this is Mark. What was the last name?
Let me get my piece of paper.
M-E-N-E. So
Manet, I think.
Yeah,
sure.
So sorry, we always butcher the last name.
Yeah, we're not good with names. So.
All right, so you can see that he collects quite a bit here. So all the way from G.I. Joe to Star Wars to Hot Wheels statues, stuff like that. So.
That's pretty cool. Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
Mori Hydro. Well, nice.
Yeah, Lino. He's got Marvel. All kinds of stuff down here.
Awesome. Oh, yes. Lego Movie. Yeah.
Just about everything.
That's how you got to collect. You got to collect everything.
Oh, Batman's. There you go, man.
I want Lego so bad right now.
He's got Apache Chief back there. Old school Super Friends, nice.
No, we said Lego, not Ego, Dakota.
Lego of my ego. Gosh.
It's a big speeder bike.
Yeah. I remember when that came out, I was like, wow, that thing's huge.
Oh, that's so awesome. He's got the Cobra Rattler up there. The X-Wing.
Interceptor. Cool.
And some Transformer stuff.
And some Jordans. Nice. I had those.
And the box. Yeah,
I know. I had those.
I've got the, what are they called? The Black Cats. I've got those. So I need to sell those, the bunch of other stuff. But Masterpiece, third-party stuff.
Apollyon. Yeah, nice.
That's a treat. Awesome display.
I so want to pick up that Apollyon. I don't know. I like it, though. Robotech.
Little Starscream section, Soundwave section. And if you have to, like he did, he had to send two emails, so that's fine. It's more
nice.
Robo down there.
Cool.
Oh, nice, the Skywarps and Thundercrackers and Cyclonus down there.
Yeah.
Oh, sweet. The Voltron stuff. Look at all that Voltron. Wait, what is this? Those are GoBots.
Cool. At least it's the cast. Our majority of them are. Cool.
I think that was it. So thanks a lot for sending in your collection. Sorry we tried to get to it last week, but you kind of know what happened. So had to edit the video. This is we're not normally going to be looking at the Prime or the RID stuff, but James has just become like such a huge collector of this that it
love it. So all my BotCon stuff for that. That's how we do it. Love it.
He's like all his masterpiece stuff is on eBay right now, so he can feed his RID.
Darn right. I want mint. On card, I want it opened. I want him also transformed.
He's getting them AFA graded. He got rid of all five of his Star Savers that he bought.
Darn right.
Love he's up with the G1 Japanese collection. He wants this strong arm.
Yeah, I do want that strong arm, though, because it looks more accurate to the cartoon with the white on the head. So, hey, I'm not alone. Derek J. Wyatt said he wanted it, too.
Oh, I remember him saying that, too. Oh, and some featured guest that we will be having, I believe in, let's see, not next week, but in 2 weeks at San Diego Comic-Con. The week after that, I believe we're going to have Rick Alvarez will play with this too. He's going to have the new prototype so he can show that off on the show. And then after that, I think we're going to have Josh Perez and Derek J. Watt again. So
awesome.
Josh Perez easily had like the best BotCon 2015 cosplay.
Yeah, I wanted to have those two on together, just because you know they were there, they were featured, and wanted to kind of get their experience. So you're gonna get this weird look at this shattered glass steel jaw here.
Shattered glass steel jaw. No.
Is that what it is? No.
I'll get the Galvatronus when it comes out.
Oh, come on.
I'll do that one.
Oh, it's doing that binging. Oh. You see all these little sound
Everyone bang? Like everything on Josh's Facebook page right now.
Dude, I can't hear anything but bing, 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 bing. Yes! So now we can kind of see the... Because they had all the glopped up colors at the Tokyo Toy Show. Now you can see the weapons are not going to be that translucent yellow. It's kind of like this nice gold paint, which that looks much better.
Dude, I want to army build those so bad.
She's so pretty.
But I'm definitely picking up one, just so I can at least enjoy the mold.
Wasn't the last picture we saw, she had a lot more accessories?
Yeah, it showed her with the guns on the hips and the swords. I don't know if it's coming with those swords, though.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, so.
Still looks good. I like it.
I like the fact that they didn't put a Decepticon logo on there since she never had one. The G1 cartoon, I have no idea about the comic, so.
No.
All right, so looking
at least not in a BotCon O1 comic.
And I like just having the two sides there because it's symmetrical. It's nice. Yeah, dude, I've wanted this figure or character for so long.
That is nice.
Let's see here.
There we go. I want that one too.
Now, I don't know how final these are, but you can definitely see that this is not glopped up paint, that this is actual you know, what it's molded in and stuff like that, and you can see some of the nice paint on here.
That's where the money is right there, that Black Arachne. That Black Arachne is on point. I like it.
I mean, I like in this mode, I get the translucent implants, but you know,
implants?
I mean, well, what else do you want
to get? I know what you mean, but it's just kind of funny.
It's like, Jesus.
Yeah. I'm curious if Hasbro's going to bring this over for the anniversary, or this is going to be it has to be re-released somehow. I mean, I'm getting the Takara version, but this is a perfect version.
Honestly, dude, it looks like Takara is really the only one focusing kind of on the whole Beast Wars anniversary, and I'm totally okay with that. You know, everything Takara puts out Beast Wars related, like, I'm getting to.
Oh,
hopefully
yeah.
We'll see a return of the Telemoca line.
Oh, you know God. What I mean?
I would thoroughly enjoy that. Get a Scissor Boy finally, or Laura, if you're listening.
I got a Scissor Boy though.
Don't rub that in my face. Don't you ever rub that in my face.
Hourglass there in the forehead too. So
yeah,
really.
Yeah, the head sculpt's so nice.
It's so spot on.
I think that's a perfect classics Black Arachnia. Like it's great.
Everybody in the chat is talking about Slipstream. Well, okay, we'll go to Slipstream.
Slipstream.
Like what? Oh,
Beast Wars love.
I know. Josh, move it along. Here's what everybody, all you guys are talking about in the chat. So here you go.
Oh, the color went green more? That was more of a bluish before. Or
I think it is more of like an aqua, seafoamy green sort of thing.
Look at her smile.
I don't know.
Still looks good, but...
I'm happy with my club one, but it looks great to say that.
Yeah.
Now, I like all three of these. James, I'm starting to think on the San Diego Comic-Con, because I think I've got a week before I've got to send my buddy the money for pick up all my stuff. The one that I don't really want is the Shadow RC, whatever her name is. The other ones...
What the hell? You don't want that one?
No, I do want that one.
Oh, okay.
It's the other two, because I know that the Windblade is going to be the Hasbro Windblade, so it's going to have that ankle issue. And then the Chromia, it looks all right. I don't love it, though. But I do. So, do I want to spend $75 plus shipping on just one figure that I really do like and two that not so much?
Depends on if you can sell them to someone else, but maybe I would try to see if someone's going to split the set maybe later on. You might be in the long run, if you just want the one, maybe you could get RC for like $40. Would you be satisfied with that?
Jim, I'm so cheap, you know.
Okay. Well, I'm just curious. I mean, if you don't want to spend the $75 to get those others, and let's say someone's going to split it and go $40 on it.
Maybe I can split with people. Someone. Maybe we can like go in on a set or something.
Dalton.
I'll see. Yeah, Dalton.
Yeah, Dalton. Get in on that.
I get the RC and you get the other two and give me $50. So. All right. Yeah, but give me $50 for the two I don't want. I do like this though. It does look nice.
Yeah.
It's a lot of nice little paint in here.
Did you guys think that this should have been like a three-pack, or it's good having them individual?
I think it's good having them individual, because if you want to buy a bunch of Nightbirds, like Dakota was saying, then you don't have to get a bunch of the other sets.
And I want two Black Arachnias, you know, one to keep in box, and I wouldn't want to have like the three of them in box. Yeah, so
I
I'm good with them being individual.
And I forgot these will be in box, too, so that's going to be cool.
Oh, so awesome. Takara.
In beast mode, you think?
I don't know. Maybe. That seems to be their kind of their deal, which I'd be okay with. I mean, I'm getting two, so it doesn't even matter.
Cool.
All right, the Takara. What is it? Warriors Unite. There's Superion. All that, like, goldish yellow, white.
Look at that Bruticus, though.
Oh, where can I get that? No. Defensor.
This is Dalton screaming, Josh. I want the full set, not taking away RC.
Nice. I like that.
What are they doing there?
Little
barbecue?
That's what you gotta do, Silverbolt. Get in that kitchen.
Oh, it's the dude from that 1G1 episode.
Yep.
Okay.
That's cool. Oh, this is what I like.
Oh, the Takara Warriors Unite.
Mm-hmm.
Protector bots. Hotspots change quite a bit there. Actually, and then Streetwise is gray.
Yep.
And then there's a few different paint applications that you mainly see in the alt mode, and then obviously Groove here.
Yeah, I like how they went with the G1 toy colors. Look at that big old motorcycle. Love it.
I mean, well, they're all misproportioned. You know?
Oh, I know, but I just love the fact that we're getting a Grooves, and it doesn't matter. Like, as far as the proportions and all that, like, we didn't get stuck with that little Legends, you know, figure.
I don't get it whenever they're like, well, you know, it's dumb to have a motorcycle that big, you know, as big as that freaking helicopter there. And I'm like, dude, this is like Transformers. Like, they've been screwing it up since, like, the very 84. So, you know, with Optimus Prime as a semi and Megatron's a gun, but Megatron's taller than Optimus in robot mode. So, I mean, this is nothing new as far as scale, so it's nothing to flip out over.
Yeah.
That's my favorite change out of all, obviously, the Grooves, but, man, I would have liked to have Streetwise Silver like this.
Yeah.
That looks so much cleaner. All right, and Machine Robo, I believe. Yeah, Machine Robo, a tough truck. So they're going to be coming out with this character here. So I just kind of put it in the import stuff. Dakota, you're really loud over there on your keyboard.
I'm so sorry. It's my big, dumb sausage fingers just typing away.
So what do you think about this stuff? Dakota, do you know a lot about Machine Robo, or is that kind of like too old for you? Or
dude, yeah, I think you're getting a little too past my age bracket.
All right.
It's neat looking, I guess. I mean, I just don't know anything about it.
Apparently, they're going to be coming out with several of the other ones as well from Machine Robo. That was one of the things that, like, you know, Takara, when they created the Transformer brand, they took some Machine Robo, Diaclone, you know, Toy Box, you know, different stuff like that. So this was one of them.
It's cool, I mean, because Machine Robo here in the States was GoBots. So for all you GoBots fans, you're going to get some love there.
Boom. So. There you go, Count Marzo.
Unfortunately, the GoBots fans are cheap, so I don't think they're going to be buying those.
I know. Like the thing is, Marzo, he's like, these GoBots are awesome when they came out with this, like, kind of really nice-looking, I don't want to say masterpiece style, but you know which one I'm talking about as far as GoBots, and I kind of told him the price on them, and I was just like, yeah, they're like, you know, $50-$60 or something like that. He was like, oh! Like, were you expecting to pay, like, 85 GoBot prices, you know? Like, just like
$2. $2. $2.
But, all right, getting into Make Toys or Mikey Toys, whichever one you want, prefer you want to call it, the remaster. Well, there's people that always like, Josh, it's Make Toys. And they're just like, no, it's Maki Toys. And then I've heard another way, too. And I'm just like, I can't please everyone. So.
I heard that on Dust Mite's Realm of Collection episode. Guys are always going, making fun of them. Is it Maki Toys? Make Toys?
You know, everybody knows what you're referring to. That so.
Well, it's the one on the far right. That's not theirs, is it? No, I'm kidding. I know what that is.
So, I mean, as far as masterpieces go, it's where it's supposed to be.
It looks good. I just, man, it's freaking masterpiece scale. I don't know.
You got Fans Project.
Yeah, Fans Project is smaller, so that's, you know.
And they're re-releasing it.
Yeah, they are. But, you know, for the masterpiece collectors that don't mind throwing third party up there with their official stuff. Not me.
I need to get a brain.
There you go.
Oh, look at the little rewind. That's cool.
You're like a little baby.
And he comes with rewind?
No.
Oh, I was like, damn, that's cool.
But that is really nice.
Yeah, it is. Spot on to the G1, though. I mean, it's like, wow.
Oh, yeah, great job.
Dual seater, though. I like the dual seater also.
All right, Unique Toys. What's his name? Warden?
Warden.
Really? Nice. Looks like it says photo by Warden, so maybe that's the...
No, it's
Warden.
O-R-D-I-N. Warden.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
We're going with the Norse mythology.
That thing is freaking huge, too. I saw it at BotCon in the Toy Dojo room, and wow, that's a big combiner.
Like taller than Hercules, like Warbitron.
No, I don't think it's Warbitron tall. Maybe the same size as Hercules. It's been a long time since I've had Hercules, so you can't just drop that question on me like that. Like, how dare you?
Sorry, man. I'm sorry.
Well, now it's all painted up though, so we can get a really good idea of the last two, Hunger and Cutthroat. We can see them all painted up. So
looks really good. I mean, it's like damn. Throw up the peace sign, that's cool. Love it.
I wonder what the Combiner Wars version is going to look like. Because honestly, dude, I think I'm going to hold out. Like, with these newer Combiner Wars figures, like the Combaticons, the Skylinks, like, all of these, like, I'm just, like, now my interest is starting to peak. And I really can't wait for them to tackle those Beast Combiners.
Yeah, I want to, like I said, I'm not going to buy any more third-party Combiners until Hasbro's kind of finished theirs, and then I see what the add-ons are, and that's probably the route I'm going to go. But if I see something that just kind of blows me away, that like the Mastermind Creations Feral Rex or Make-Toys Green Giant, like those two just blew me away. I knew I had to have them. Like that's when I'll buy from them. So.
Right. But a Piranacon, so Takara can give me a God Neptune. Can't wait for it.
They're not going to do that, so...
They're going to do it. Takara will.
This is from Warbitron. This is supposed to be kind of like your little companion, dude. For the new one. But you can buy him, or he's actually up for pre-order today. I believe he's only going to be $31 or $30.99, so $31.
It's not too bad.
Cute little dude.
Huh. Okay. Warbitron?
Yeah.
Where's that Menasaur?
What are we doing with... everything but...
I didn't even know they're dipping into the Dinobot.
Everybody's dipping into the Dinobots.
It's like, dang, okay, cool.
Oh, there you go, so you can see size. He's like a little bitty dude. Or like a little, kind of a Legends.
Oh, cool.
Now, I heard something about the little brain thing to connect for, like, their Computron, because that's what it's supposed to be, kind of like the companion to go to that.
Oh, okay, now I get it.
So, that's why it's smaller. So you obviously see these two accessories, the ones that he would obviously come with a sword and his blaster, but I also heard something about the little brain thing, so that's probably something that will happen. If not, another third part, Dr. Wu will do it. So
that would defeat the purpose if they didn't do that. I mean, that's the whole reason I would think to have this little guy is to have that kind of displayed where Computron, Grimlock, we don't have the smarts. So you will, don't worry, bend down here, I give you all my smarts, and then you go back to being dumb. So
being
so
I can't handle that kind of humor right now.
All right, so I wanted to show off the G Creations and the Toy World, so you can kind of get the side by side. I don't know how if it's scale or whatever, like if they matched up the picture, so
they look like they're kind of the same height, so I don't know which one's bigger than what, but...
Oh, G-Creation, I think, is...
I think it is bigger.
Yeah, it's way bigger.
The G-Creation's like, wow, I mean, they both look great.
Yeah. Dang. It's cool.
Silly episode. What, man? You got Abominus and, you know, Technobots. Dude, I like it. I like a lot of the Season 3 stuff. What is it? Carnage in C Minor? Yeah, that's the worst episode ever, but I like watching it for all the mistakes. James?
Who was that supposed to be?
Oh.
With Bumblebee there.
I'm sorry, I just went all quiet, so... this is X-Transbots. This is the...
Windcharger?
Boost hatch prototype. Yeah, so the Windcharger.
Oh, okay.
They're, quote-unquote, not Masterpiece-styled or whatever, or sized.
Take that Apollyon, center base. Cool. I am looking forward to Takara's next mini-bot. Curious to what it's going to be.
Oh, God, it's going to be Wheelie, isn't it?
Cheetor, yeah. No, Rat Trap. I'm sure it's going to be Masterpiece Rat Trap. I'm looking forward to it, too, now that you mention it.
And I think it might be Wheelie. I mean, think about it. Next year's 86 movie anniversary.
Whoa, check the retro...
Maybe.
Retgar. Nice.
This is by KFC.
Crash
Hog.
Cool.
He's got his.
Does it turn into a tape?
What? Does he?
Yeah. Sounds like KFC.
No. It's going to turn into a motorcycle.
Oh. It still looks pretty neat. The flames on the tank make it go faster, too. He's part of a 1%er club. I'm just going to build the story as we go.
I guess here. There's already several other Rengars out there. It was Unique Toys. I thought KFC had already done one. Well, yeah.
And then we're getting another little Rengar for Combiner Wars.
Yeah, but I was talking about, like, you know, the bigger ones. I thought there was Unique Toys. There's like another one out there too, and all this. So,
I'll be honest, dude. I like the old generations Retgar. Like that was a really good mold, but these are definitely more on par to 86 accuracy. So that's cool too.
No, Tulala. I'm not buying a bunch of primals.
What? You're buying some primals?
No, he says we know the truth. He's going to be buying a bunch of primals. No, that's not the truth. Getting into the add-ons, Perfect Effect. This is the head. They obviously have the other add-on there where you can see the white hands, the white feet. But this has the center chest area that goes down through here and the head.
I like to see the upgrade sets. Like I thoroughly enjoy seeing those. So... Glad to know they're not a thing of the past.
Yeah, so here you got original. This is what you get. And then if you just add the PC-01, that is the feet, or I guess it's going to be 5, but it's basically, you know, the hands and feet. So it would be this. And then if you want to go the next step and add the PC-03, that adds the centerpiece and the new head.
See, I think the one in the center is perfect too, but definitely... the end result with the new head.
And the face is going to be able to flip back and forth to give you those two different looks.
Very nice.
So you're going to be able to have, you know, face plate and also mouth.
Oh, cool.
So, yep, plan on getting all that. So, there it is with the face plate and red eyes. So. Yeah, man, that looks so much better. Oh, God.
So much cheaper than TFC as well.
Unless you already got it.
No, dude, that looks good. Like, I already like the Combiner Wars aerial bots. So, I mean, wow, that's kind of swaying me to making a purchase I don't really necessarily need to make. I don't like you right now, Josh.
I'm just saying this is the vision that I had. I was like, you know, after maybe one or two little upgrade things, whatever, then and you don't have to necessarily go all through Perfect Effect. Maybe you go get Beats and Hands from Perfect Effect. Maybe there's another company that comes out with something with like chest or waist and face, you know, like beef something else up that you're like, okay, that makes it better, you know, to you.
Dude, that looks so good. Stop. Go to the next thing. I'm done with you.
This is what I kind of envisioned the Combiner Wars to be, kind of the end product, the end result. So,
yeah.
Then you can also implement it, use it as a shield. Who is going to be doing it that way?
I would. I don't know. I like to display the combiners in like their individual forms too.
But you're going to pay $30 for a shield?
Yeah. Okay. If I get it, like, I mean, if you keep on this, like, I might, you know.
All right, getting into Minasaur. We know
they made him look good. Like, don't even play with me.
So the things that you're gonna get on this one,
you're
gonna get a new head. You're gonna get this section that fits over here at the top, and that also fills out the waist, so this doesn't look like it's just huge square boob and then like itty bitty waist, and then also. You're also going to get a center part to go in between the sword to make the sword actually longer. So.
Oh my god, I'm very tempted right now.
Perfect effect's turning into Crazy Debbie. Dang.
Dude, yeah, perfect effect just made a Minasaur I hated into a Minasaur I love.
So original, pretty bad. I've already got this, so you add on the feet and the hands, but, you know, something's still missing, and then you add this, and you notice that they switch the legs around the way that they're done, so that might be something that I'll go ahead and do right now, but I think that looks much better that way.
Oh, dude.
I like that. That's what I envisioned. Yeah.
That is very clean. Wow.
And you see the center part for the sword there to make it longer?
Now I want G2 Minasaur, and I want to get that add-on for in the G2 colors. I want that right now.
And obviously, this is just the hands and feet stuff.
Dude, you guys maybe get me into Combiner Wars, and I'm not okay with that.
So that's everything that you get right there. I'm already like sold on Defensor, and I've already got the black hands and feet for him. I'm curious, like what kind of waist section they're going to come out with and maybe extend the legs and make him look even better. So I'm excited about this stuff. All right, and we've got a couple of different add-ons for your Combiner Wars Megatron. So this one's DX9. And I think, like mentioned before, that this is this back gun section. Looks like hands. Something to cover up the little shooter, the feet, and these side pieces. Yeah, for around the legs. Yeah, that's what those are for, so. So that's basically what you're going from. You're going from, there he is, stock, to there he is with the add-on. That's
not
pretty
too bad, yeah. That's pretty clean.
I think that this really helped a lot, you know, adding this around here in the back. Yeah, that's a pretty nice job. It actually is kind of tempting to go buy that thing right now.
Okay, dude, my Walmart stacked with them too.
Yeah, I got a ton of them. I don't have my car this weekend. I had to loan my mom my car. My brother broke the garage door, and now our car's stuck in there. Well, I don't need my car this weekend, so. Hope you remember how to drive a stick. Man, that's pretty nice. All right, so you got to get a look at that one because there's also X2 toys that I'm going to show you next. So you can kind of see which one maybe you like better. So if you remember with the X2 toys, it's mainly like this leg section with these feet that wrap around there. I don't see anything else. Or I don't remember anything else. I think I like the DX9, to be honest.
Yeah, I don't know. I like the black on the legs right there a lot. But, I mean, I don't know.
I like all the extra little bits.
Yeah, the other one.
With the other guy.
Yeah.
James still here?
Huh? What's up?
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I don't know. They're okay, but I'm not gonna pick them up.
Oh, what's this?
Belzebuff. So you're gonna get this chest section with a new head, which I think looks pretty cool. The little smirk gun and very a nice suitcase.
I had no clue how much I would enjoy that mold until, like, Karzap. Like, now I want Ghost Shooter, and this looks super tempting, but I'll probably pass. But it looks great.
All right, get into
Josh, that's...
Hey.
What's this?
Well, guys, I'll see you all next week.
All right. July 9th. I believe it's July 9th. Let's see, the non-Transformer stuff, and then if guys, if you have any questions or topics, put question in capital letters.
Why are we looking at Batgirl?
Well, I just wanted to show, this is the stuff that's going to be at Toys R Us, so on July 9th, it will go live, San Diego Comic-Con stuff, I'm buying that, so why wouldn't we look at it? But
it's cool.
G.I. Joe's. Glad to see G.I. Joe's like still at least getting something other than JoCon stuff.
That's pretty sweet.
Yeah. Yeah. Stuff didn't sell last year, and I think it's gonna sell this year.
Yeah.
Because it's still at the last year stuff is still at Toys R Us.
All right, we're not looking at this stuff. So.
Oh, nice that Raiden. Is that what line is it? Is that going to be the little 3¾-inch line that they've, they came out with like for the last couple, last video game?
I think it's a 6-inch.
I'm going to confirm it here in a second. There's that. I know James collects a few Power Rangers stuff.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
The Black Convoy Megazord. I don't know. You lost me.
And this is cool if you're the 3¾-inch collector. Yeah, that's nice, dude. Look at that. I want this. I just want that. Because I'm a 6-inch collector. But... And this as well. So July 9th, I even talked to a manager buddy at Toys R Us today, and I was reading up online at several other places. They don't have the time locked down yet. It will be July 9th during San Diego Comic-Con. I believe, what is that, like a Thursday? I think that is a Thursday. They said when it gets to about a week, you can ask your local Toys R Us, or we will let you know the Cybercast that previous week, what time it's supposed to go live. That way you can sit there on ToysRUs.com and keep on hitting that refresh button. So
can't believe that thing's going for stupid money right now on eBay.
What, Masterpiece Blue Streak?
Yeah. Huh. There's pre-orders for it, like, for $200.
What?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's like,
Love you, baby. Don't worry.
I don't know. The Batman's pretty cool. I mean, I like that. I mean, I saw all that huge, like, display they had at Walmart with all that 60s stuff, which is cool that they finally came out with the Batgirl. This is a freaking disappointment, though.
Dude, I was so mad about this. I went on like a little rant because for a week they showed just like a milling cart or whatever, and they were like, yeah, you know, it's 11 inches tall. And so what did everyone else think? Probably the same as I did. I was like, Krang or Shredder? Classics, yes. Because they, you know, they're not going to be able to mass produce it for a while, or maybe they'll look into that again whenever the movie comes out. But we've been told that it's been put on hold. That's why we haven't got those classics figures. Maybe we're getting some type of exclusive. Maybe it's in April. Maybe it's a Splinter or something. You know, a Foot Soldier. It's this thing which doesn't cater to like kids because it's too big, and obviously adult collectors, what it's going to be priced for, don't want it either.
Hmm. I mean, I like Chrome and all, but no, I ain't picking that up.
No. So I you read the comments through here on the page, dude. Everybody's like, pass, pass, pass. Why?
If I were a turtle collector, I would pass.
Yeah.
I mean, they did a San Diego Comic-Con Leo last year or the year before, but it didn't do anything, and this is what they're going to release that, and then I'm sure they're not going to release the other three, though.
No.
So it's like, what's the point? Is this Hot Toys?
No, this is NECA.
Wow.
The penguin they were working on, the quarter scale NECA's Batman Returns penguin, and now they've shown all the accessories he comes with as well.
Cool.
Dude, look how dead on accurate that is.
Yeah.
Look at those teeth, too. Jesus.
That's... Wow.
That's cool. Goes good with their Batman that they released.
Look at that hair. Just pick one up and get Danny DeVito to sign it.
Oh, yeah, dude. Oh.
They doing Catwoman?
That'll be
bomb. I'm just saying.
Just a cash grab, you know? Nice. I like how his jacket is removable.
And the top hat, everything.
Yeah. Dude, they did a great job.
Stepped right out of the movie.
Yeah.
And you can see like all the holes here with the skin showing through.
With his little Feetums pajamas on.
They nailed the way that they did the makeup in the movie. It looks like they nailed that, too, the way they made it look like it was a flipper.
He's got the fish.
Here, have a button.
Here's a different set of hands. That's cool.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. Looks like it. Oh, yeah, he's grabbing something, so maybe he comes with an umbrella, maybe.
Where he's eating his fish. What is it called? A unicorn or something?
Monocle.
Monocle? Okay.
A unicorn.
I don't know. It was something like that. I don't wear glasses, so.
He's a smoker. Awesome.
Dude, that is what like has me just like nice. Like they did not falter for you know the mainstream hoopla or whatever.
Yeah.
Like they're like accuracy. That I think is really cool. Like, they didn't give him a candy cane.
Yeah. I mean, that is really cool. They're not constrained by any means.
And this is like, real fur.
You didn't get this much with the original Batman, which is, wow. They really stepped it up for this line. Josh? I guess it's Josh's time to...
Did it freeze on him? Yeah. Alright, this is the Primal Sabbath corner, so let's fire it up. So we're going to talk about how great the Masterpiece Gorilla Convoy is. Perfect in every way. Probably going to be the best Masterpiece they've put out to date.
Yeah.
You know, going to buy five. You know, I said I was only going to buy two, but going to buy five.
Here's the thing I want to ask you really quickly on that. Do you think they're going to Takara is going to do what they did with the movie Masterpiece and give it a separate line? Or is it going to be actually integrated into the Masterpiece with its own numbering?
Dude, that is a good question. I kind of hope they just do it like they did the movie Masterpiece stuff, but, you know, like, more than just freaking Starscream and Bumblebee.
Yeah, obviously.
Which, granted, like, the movie Masterpiece, like, those were repaints. You know, that's a new mold, and that's awesome.
Yeah.
But we're still live, so that's cool.
We are?
Yeah. Josh just has to, like, rejoin. Anyways, you know, so I'm hoping it's kind of like a subline. But, you know, from what the little news post or whatever at the convention said, it was like, you know, year of the Masterpiece Beast Wars or whatever. So I don't know if it's just going to be Primal or maybe if they're going to be able to knock out the whole, like, season one cast. It's really, in hindsight, it's like not that many figures, you know what I mean?
True.
It is something that they could do within a year's time, you know, or what have you. But yeah, I don't know. I'm definitely looking forward to it. I cannot wait to see some more pictures and advancement on that. It's a really, really cool thing that I'm really getting into.
I'm hoping we get a Megatron.
Oh yeah, dude.
Definitely.
It's like we're getting Primal. Why wouldn't we get Megatron?
And just one that has a lot more articulation. You can actually take the tail shield off. I mean, the only one that we had was
Rubber Ducky.
It would be nice to have that. And then get a Dinobot.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone's going to want Dinobot Rat Trap.
It's like, as much as I want my Classics Beast Wars shelf to, you know, be complete, I have no problem starting the Masterpiece Beast Wars shelf. Like, I'll figure something out.
Yeah.
Some of the BotCon sets may have to live in a box until I get some more shelving units, but we'll get it done. We will get it done.
It would be cool if they did a limited edition of those as far as the Masterpieces, like, versus box.
Oh, dude.
Packaged together.
Like, I want Gary and David, like, at the next BotCon, like, after those come out. Because I already need to get an original Primal for Chalk to sign. Because I got David to sign that Megatron that I just picked up last minute at last year's BotCon. But, oh, goodness. I would be in and out of that autograph line a lot.
So how was BotCon?
Dude, it was an absolute blast. Like, I had so much fun. And, you know, for what it's worth, like, I enjoyed the souvenirs, like, immensely, all of them. I, you know, last year I had my, you know, nitpicks about every, you know, most of everything. But dude, the box set, I think the box set killed it. And I, you know, like the Megatron, I was kind of meh on, but after getting it and actually kind of playing with the mold and seeing how well it does with the character, reading the comic, you know, it definitely grew on me. But I already loved the box set as it was, with the souvenirs. Everything, yeah, even the Diaclone stuff. Like, I'm for the most part, like, I was just kind of meh on the Diaclone, of them ever doing Diaclone, but I think they did it right, and I don't know. I enjoyed the figures, but the actual convention itself, it was just so fun. The panels were great. John Moshida as the auctioneer at the charity auction was, that was just cool. Like, I bid it on a few things, but nothing super crucial. But just with him kind of doing that, like, I thought that was a very awesome experience. And John was, you know, of course, Susan Blue, like, she was super approachable, just like she was last year. She was feeling a little sick on a couple of days. But John, he was another dude that was just totally approachable. Like, people could just, you know, he'd just walk up to you and start talking to you. Awesome. That was really awesome. The Welker panel, there's a video up on YouTube of the Welker panel.
Okay.
And that was a very awesome panel. I was in on that. Thankfully, it didn't completely pack out. It was close, but that was a cool. This one seemed a little more fun, and it helped that dealer room, you know, which is where autographs were, and panel area were all so close to each other. So you're not, it wasn't like 2014 where you had to like sprint to go get, or you just miss out on autographs. And that's another thing, only having four guests, you know, John and Susan had their autograph session. Then you had Derek and Kojin for their autograph session.